We all know that the future of healthcare is data-driven, AI-powered. I don't just mean the people in this room, in fact, the industry, academics, everyone. So the future is data-driven, AI-powered. That is, we are going to collect data, clinical data, from patients continuously in their homes, track their symptoms, the evolution of those symptoms, and process this data with machine learning so that we can get insight before problems occur, and we can react to it, intervene early, avoid hospitalization, and improve outcomes for patients. But all of that, it depends on clinical data. How do you get clinical data today from patients? We either stick a needle in their body, or we strap them into some machine or sensors. These pictures are not, like, as you can imagine, very comfortable to the patients. But not just that, it also means that we are getting sporadic data. We get some data point here and another data point later, 6 months when the patient takes another test. We are unable to track the dynamics of symptom evolutions in diseases. But what if somebody comes and tells you, look, just gonna be doing something completely different. Can you use the wireless signal around all of us? You are swimming in wireless signals, like Wi-Fi kind of signal, cellular. We're gonna use that wireless signal that bounce off people's body. We're gonna process it with machine learning. And we're gonna do it continuously in patient homes all the time so that we can track their symptoms and the evolution of those symptoms. This is exactly what we have been doing with my group and students here at MIT. So let me show you an illustrative video. So wireless signal spread inside the home. It traverses walls on occlusions because it's wireless signal, and it bounces off our body because our bodies are made of water. And some of these signals come back to our device, analyze them, we detect in this case a fall, can alert the caregiver via text, email, or phone call. Now, this is an illustrative video. Can we do that with real people? Okay. So, what you see here, the big frame, is what the wireless device sees through a wall. So these thick figures actually are detectable using radio signals completely. What you see on the side there are the people inside the room. And this is just for you guys so that you see what's happening in the scene. So imagine if somebody is monitoring us, not from here, but from behind that wall, because we all know wireless signal traverse walls. Now, you can see when he sits on a chair, the radio device knows actually he's sitting. When he walks, it knows that he's walking. When he's moving with his right foot, it knows that it's his right foot. When he's moving with the left foot, it knows that. And it's all because when we move, we are changing the electromagnetic waves around us through a wall. Of course, everything that we do, we compare to the gold standard in the case of motion, is something called the motion Viking capture room. And we show that it is highly accurate. So we can also monitor something that's related to your brain waves. When you go to sleep, your brain waves change and you enter different stages, awake, light sleep, deep sleep, rapid eye movements. Now, of course, we know that these sleep stages are related to sleep disorders. One in every three Americans has sleep problem. But it's not just about sleep. It's not about sleep disorders. In fact, every neurological disease has connection with sleep. In fact, almost every disease and every illness is reflected in your sleep. So just to give you an example, rapid eye movements, REM, is there are if people who have depression, one of the very common symptoms of depression is that REM starts happening too early during sleep. Think about Alzheimer's, right? People who have Alzheimer's, there is impairment typically in the slow waves in deep sleep. So if you can monitor all of this accurately, not only you are learning about sleep, but you are learning about so many diseases. Today, if you want to get sleep staging accurately, you send someone to a sleep lab, they put these electrodes on his head and body, and they ask him to sleep like this. This is from the MGH sleep lab. You can see he's not happy. I don't know how many of you guys, I'm guessing like some percentage of you have been to a sleep lab. You know, it's not really comfortable, but it's actually surprising. When I, as a computer scientist, when I learned that this is how we assess sleep, I was very surprised because to me, this is not gonna be representative of my sleep. Not to mention that my sleep is bad, but this is gonna make it a disaster. Let me show you how we monitor sleep. Okay, this is our device. Transmit very low power wireless signal, 1,000 times lower power than Wi-Fi, analyzes the signal using specialized neural network, and spits out the sleep stages. What you see here is something called a hypnogram. A hypnogram is what you get in a sleep lab when they put all of this stuff on your head and body. For every 30 seconds, it tells you you're on light sleep, deep sleep, REM, et cetera. And of course, everything is compared to the gold standard in the case of this is going to be PSG, like the stuff that you have with all of the sensor on his head and body. This person is sitting like you guys, and what you see on the screen, his inhales, exhales. We ask him to hold his breath. You're gonna see the signal stays at a steady level. Because he exhaled, he did not inhale. And again, this is compared to gold standard from an FDA-approved breathing device that you have to wear on your body. And it's highly accurate. Over the last 3 years, we have been working with hospitals, pharma, medical doctors in a variety of diseases. And as we are speaking now, today, there are hundreds of these devices with patients deployed, creating an IoT network of health devices. In Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, rare diseases such as Rett syndrome, Crohn's, immune diseases. You don't think that immune diseases, actually immune diseases have so much information to reveal to us, Crohn's, lupus, et cetera. And I'm just going to give you one example so that you can see once you get devices like this with patients continuously monitoring clinical signal, the power, the new power that you can get. And that I'm going to use for it Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's, I mean, I'm sure all of you guys know Parkinson's. It's like it comes with the tremor and the stiffness of motion. Parkinson is the fastest growing neurological disease in the world. It is the second most common neurological disease after Alzheimer's. One of the biggest problems in Parkinson's, actually it's also similar to Alzheimer's, is that we detect the disease, we diagnose Parkinson's late, sometimes 10 years after the disease has started in the brain. And the problem is that by the time we diagnose the disease, almost 50 to 80% impairment already exists in the brain in our dopamine capability. Dopamine is the underlying problem with Parkinson's. So if already, like, by the time we diagnose, can be 80% the brain is damaged, and you can understand why it's very hard to develop drugs for Parkinson or to treat Parkinson's. So what we ask is, can machine learning diagnose Parkinson in a different way? If we want to diagnose Parkinson early, we need to stop or not avoid using the motor symptoms, because the motor symptoms is the way we diagnose Parkinson today, and they happen late in the disease. But if we want to diagnose Parkinson before the motor symptoms, then we can't use the motor symptoms. What can we use? So we, with my students, we started reading about medical literature, and we discovered that James Parkinson, the doctor who actually we named Parkinson after him, he says that breathing actually changes in patients. But no medical expert, the best Parkinson doctor, cannot diagnose Parkinson based on breathing. Can machine learning do it? So let me show you. So we ask, can AI detect Parkinson's disease from nocturnal breathing? We take a nice breathing signal, and we train a neural network to answer two questions. Does this person have Parkinson's? And if they do, what is the severity of their disease according to the gold standard, which is something called MDS-UPDRS? And this is a large study that has 7,000 different individuals, 700 of them have Parkinson's disease. It's collaboration with MGH, Mayo Clinic, and Rochester University. And let me show you the results. So these are called ROC curves. On the x-axis, you have specificity. On the y-axis, you have sensitivity. But the number that you have to look at is this AUC. And one way to interpret the AUC is that with an accuracy of 90%, we can detect whether this person has Parkinson's or not, just from their breathing. Not we, like the machine. Now, the very interesting question to ask, the next natural question, can we detect Parkinson's early before actually it's clinically diagnosed? And we don't have a large data set where we actually have data before the person was diagnosed, and then we know that they were diagnosed later. But we have a small data set that has two visits of the individual that are separated by 6 years. So we went to the first visit, took breathing data from that first visit, and asked, can we tell who got Parkinson's and told us that they got Parkinson's 6 years later? And let me show you the results. So can we detect Parkinson's before clinical diagnosis? The guys in blue are the people who eventually reported 6 years later. When they came for the second visit, they said, I was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. The guys, or the individuals with red, are the ones that never developed Parkinson's disease, neither on the first study nor 6 years later. You can see that the neural network actually can tell. It's like there is something wrong with these guys there. I mean, I think that they have Parkinson's. So we are just scratching the surface, discovering what computer science can bring to medicine and biomedical research. And also with my students here, my PhD students who graduated at MIT, we started a company called Emerald to bring this technology to healthcare and drug development. Thank you very much.